Order. Can I enjoy saying that for the last time, please? Order. The sitting is resumed. And before moving on to the rest of today's business, I would like to take this opportunity to make some brief remarks at the beginning of this new Assembly term. Once I have presided over the election of my successor, I will leave office. And therefore, before we move on to that business, I would like to just give you my remarks in relation to the working relationships, my appreciation of how well and effectively this Assembly can work on those issues that our electorate expect. I also want to put down my understanding of how this Assembly has become actually vitally important to our wider community, and that is reflected at times when it appears that we have we've encountered impasse and difficulties. What you begin to hear is sometimes just through the chattering classes, like speculation about the collapse of this Assembly, and then you start to hear the more kind of concerned and focused and informed opinions about how vital, in terms of a community that has our history of conflict and division, really needs this Assembly to be part of the cement and the process of reconciliation and healing. So in my view, I think the election has demonstrated that despite the negative kind of commentaries that all of us pick up, and despite the reactions at times on the doors, and I think legitimate comments one way or the other, you also get a very clear affirmation of how vital this Assembly is to the day-to-day existence and the people's expectation of a more peaceful future than we've had in the past. Many members will know that throughout my time in office, I focus on the need of the Assembly to show respect towards all of its people. It has been a tremendous opportunity to host so many events and to meet so many different elements in our diverse community. And in that context, I'm delighted to look out today in a chamber with 50% more women than following the outcome of the previous election. We have much more to do on that front, but it is, I think, a very good beginning, and I know that I'm leaving behind many who will continue to focus on the composition of this Assembly going forward and reflecting the actual composition to ensure that we do, in mathematical terms as well as electoral terms, we represent the entire community. I want to give my thanks to the three Deputy Speakers, Roy Biggs, John Dallet, and Principal Deputy Speaker Robin Newton, for their support and cooperation. It is important for the occupants of the chair to be able to depend and rely on each other to enforce and to deliver on the rulings of the Speaker. And I could not have wished for a better working relationship amidst some very, very challenging and difficult issues, and I sincerely thank them for that. I also want to thank the Assembly Commission members. It is a function, a vitally important corporate function, but very much in most circumstances out of the public eye. And I want to acknowledge the role and the contribution of Pat Ramsey, Peter Weir, Judith Cochran, Katrina Ryan, Sam Gardner, Paula Bradley, and Karen McKevitt. It's easy for those on the outside to underestimate the difficulties and the challenges that the Commission often faces in delivering on its statutory obligations and achieving agreement amongst diverse views. However, it can best be done through constructive discussions, developing strong working relationships, and leaving the politics for this chamber. So I thank the Commission for their cooperation on so many issues. I think it's appropriate also that I would thank the staff of this Assembly. I've been a member here since 1998, but really it was only during my time as Speaker that I gained the fullest appreciation of just how much work is required behind the scenes to support the operation of the Assembly and the challenges and pressures on a daily basis that Assembly staff face in often is a very confrontational and difficult environment. So I have a renewed admiration for them, and I thank them, and I think I thank them on behalf of all in this chamber for their support and also for the occasional banter. Can I also give my thanks to the Clerk Chief Executive, Trevor Rainey. At the end of next month, Trevor will be following me into retirement. not oblivion, I'm certain, but I want to thank him for his work and support. In even the most difficult exchanges, Trevor maintains calmness, courtesy and respect and offers solutions, but he's most characterised by his absolute commitment to serve the best interests of this Assembly, its members and staff, and I thank him for his leadership. I also want to thank my colleagues and friends in the Speaker's office. And I know that previous speakers have acknowledged the calibre of support and expertise and experience that exists there. But I will name Robin Ramsay, a vital source of knowledge, experience and vision, and absolute commitment to ensuring that the Speaker gets the best possible support. I want to thank Francis Lenehan, because behind all the previous incumbents of the Speaker's chair, there is the woman who actually ensures that it will all happen and done according to the script. And then Paul and Christopher complete the picture in relation to what I think is a remarkable team that we should all be proud of. If I could just comment on the role of the Speaker before I step down from the role. From the outset, I made it clear that I recognise the importance of the role of the Speaker in representing every single member of this establishment. So I was the representative of 107 other MLAs, not a party political position. In a few minutes, the Assembly will be electing a new Speaker to do that and uphold the independence and the impartiality of the office. However, it's important for members to equally remember that after the Speaker is elected, so that when members come to see the Speaker in relation to issues that they're concerned about, they shouldn't just come with their own party or their personal perspective. At least they shouldn't come without acknowledging that the Speaker has a responsibility to be impartial and to take account of all the diverse views in this Assembly. So the Speaker's not there to become involved in a ping-pong between the party political interests. There's plenty of other structures and opportunities for those issues to be addressed. But the Speaker, and it's important for everybody and it's to everybody's advantage, should be protected in the independence and the impartiality of their role. The Assembly is moving on, and in welcoming a new generation and wider perspectives, there are a few left like me who were here in 1998, but those remaining members represent a very significant corporate memory of how far we have come and the work that was required to achieve that. And that's important because sometimes we do hear complacent voices about focusing on the imperfections of this institution rather than appreciating of where we might otherwise be without this Assembly. There are many difficulties ahead, but I am entirely optimistic about the future and this Assembly. However, I lay down the challenge that is for every single member in this chamber to try to make the most of this Assembly. We have seen that we can only move forward when we find agreement, and I welcome very much the approach that has developed in recent terms, where people simply stay at the table in the midst of all the disagreements until a solution emerges. Much more will be achieved through positive energy, focus on finding that agreement and respecting other opinions, even though there is much negative energy to feed on if we were to take account of it. My colleague in Westminster, Speaker John Bercow, speaks of the need for the Speaker to be impartial between the parties, but never impartial about the institution. Similarly here, the Speaker should be fair and impartial between all shades of opinion, but should never be impartial about recognising the importance of the Assembly and wanting the best for it. So it has been a privilege to end my time in this place as Speaker, and I sincerely wish you all the very best for the future, and I sincerely wish my successor all the success and the support that I enjoyed. Thank you all very much indeed. Well, I will say it one more time, order. I've had the opportunity to scrutinise the entries in the undertaking and role of membership, and I'm satisfied that all members have taken their seats in accordance with standing orders. Indeed, Mr. Ford, point of order.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I was slightly surprised when I read the notes indicating procedure for this morning, which refer to members giving a designation, nationalist, unionist or other, with an initial capital and quotation marks around it, when paragraph 6 of strand 1 of the Good Friday Agreement specifically puts nationalist, unionist or other in lower case with no quotation marks. For the sake of doubt, My colleagues and I have given our designation as United Community. You may regard it as something different.
The point of order and the point you make, but you will be aware that our procedures are based on the original legislation and standing orders has to reflect that accurately. So, Wade's taking your point about the grammatical kind of issue, can I just indicate that regarding designations of identity, 12 members, I have deemed 12 members based on the designation they had offered, and other members of other political groupings here took similar kind of objection to the options that were available. But I made it clear before we started that process that it would be for me to decide the basis on which they would be designated for the purposes of voting and the procedures going forward. So I've deemed that there are 12 members who have entered designations that I have deemed to be other for the purposes of standing orders. And details of all the designations have been placed in members' pigeonholes, and copies are available in the rotunda. The next item of business is the election of the Speaker. Members will be aware that I'm not seeking re-election as Speaker. Therefore, I will only remain in this chair for that process and will step down immediately once my successor has been elected. I wish to advise members that the election of the Speaker will be conducted under the procedures that have been set out under Standing Orders 4. I will begin by asking for nominations. Any member may rise to propose that another member is elected as Speaker. I will then ask for the proposal to be seconded by another member as required by Standing Order 14. I will then verify that the member seconded is willing to accept the nomination. I will then ask for further proposals and follow the same procedure for each. When it appears that there are no further proposals, I will make it clear that the time for proposals has passed. If members indicate that they wish to speak, a debate relevant to the election may then take place. At the conclusion of the debate, or the conclusion of the nominations, if there are no requests to speak, I shall put the question that the member first proposed shall be the Speaker of this Assembly, and the vote will be on a cross-community basis. If the proposal is not carried, I shall then put the question in relation to the next nominee, and so on until nominations are exhausted. Once the Speaker is elected, all other nominations will fall automatically. Do you have any proposals for the office of Speaker of this Assembly? Ms. Foster.
Thank you very much, Speaker. And can I say, and with your indulgence, just before I make my proposal, this is the first day of the new sitting. It is a new era. Every election brings change. And I want to thank you, as outgoing Speaker, for your service to this House. I want to thank the outgoing clerk as well for the service to this House. And I want, therefore, to nominate the name of Mr. Robin Newton for Speaker.
Thank you. Is there a member to second that proposal?
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. And I rise to nominate or to second the nomination of my good friend and colleague Robin Newton.
And are there any other nominations? Can I then just establish that? Can I ask the nominated person? Are they prepared to accept the proposal?
I accept the nomination.
Thank you. Okay, any further proposals? Then the time for proposals has expired. A number of members have indicated that they wish to speak, at least one has. I would remind members that they may speak only once in the course of the debate, and members have up to 3 minutes in which to speak. And I call Ms. Arlene Foster.
Thank you very much, and I'm delighted to propose my party colleague Robin Newton to the office of Speaker. And if elected today, I'm sure that Robin will bring great dignity and sure-footedness to the position. He has a long and distinguished career in public service, first with Belfast City Council and then here in the Northern Ireland Assembly. And during his time in the Assembly, he has served as a junior minister and has led the DUP team in the policing board. Robin has been honoured by Her Majesty the Queen and is a member of the British Empire. He was first elected in 2003 and thereby is a veteran of this House. That makes me a veteran of this House as well, which I'm rather alarmed at. But anyway, he had many years' experience of the procedures of the Assembly, even before he was elevated to Principal Deputy Speaker last year. And over this last 15 months in post, Robin has proven himself in the role and superbly well qualified to hold the post. Indeed, over this last 15 months in particular, and indeed across his whole career, Robin has demonstrated that he is an ideal candidate for the post. If such a thing exists, Mr Speaker, in this House, Robin Newton is a conciliator, and I suspect at times it will take all of his natural skills to manage this new term. But I have no doubt that he will carry out his duties in a fashion that will be recognised by members as impartial and fair, and I do urge all members of this House to support Robin Newton as our next Speaker.
Thank you very much, and I call Mr Martin McGuinness.
Well, can I first of all like the First Minister pay tribute to you, Mitchell, as Speaker. I think that in the course of your stewardship of that department, that you clearly followed on from the Trojan work that was done prior to your appointment by a fellow dairyman, William Hay, now Lord Hay. And I think in the context of the last two terms of the Assembly, the work done by both William and by yourself, I think sent a very powerful message to everyone about the ability of Unionists and Republicans to inhabit that chair in a way that showed them to be totally fair and impartial. I think also the work that you've done to raise up women within this Assembly was very, very important, and I too join with you in congratulating all those women who have been elected to this Assembly and look forward to the day when even more will be elected in the not-too-distant future. I have no difficulty whatsoever in supporting Robin Newton as the new Speaker of the Assembly. I do think that he will follow in the practice of William Hay and yourself and will recognise his duties and responsibilities to everybody in this House to ensure that there is fairness and that no one can leave this House and say that in any way the office was demeaned by a partisan approach. That certainly didn't happen in the context of William Hay. It didn't happen with you, and I have every confidence that it won't happen with Robin either, and I wish him well.
Thank you. And the question is that Robin Newton be Speaker of this Assembly. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. And as it arises from all sides of the House and there are no dissenting voices, I am satisfied that cross-community support has been demonstrated. And I formally declare and congratulate Robin Newton as being elected as Speaker, and I invite him to take the chair.
Can I thank the members for entrusting me with this office, this very important office, as Speaker of the Assembly. I particularly appreciate, and the Deputy First Minister has referred to it, I particularly appreciate the very radical move of selecting someone from outside the Maiden City to hold the post. I do want to thank my predecessor, Mitchell McLaughlin, for his dedication to the Assembly and his even-handed treatment of members. And I appreciated that both as a member on the benches and indeed in the role of Principal Deputy Speaker. And despite his short time in office, he leaves this Assembly being held in very high esteem, not only recognised in here, but recognised further afield. And we wish him well, as the First Minister has said, for the future. The Assembly returns after this election with a diverse range of opinions on all the issues and indeed the many challenges that we will face over this mandate. I fully accept the requirement to preside in a manner which is independent, impartial of the office, and to uphold the standards that my predecessors have set. But I do recognise the role of the Speaker to be firm and indeed to protect the interests and the integrity and the procedures of this House, but also to be fair in the way that the business is conducted. Therefore, members can be assured that I will be doing my best to uphold the rights of every part of the House, every part of the Chamber, to express their views and the concerns of their constituents. The people of Northern Ireland are looking to us. They want this Assembly, and I want this Assembly, to prove to them that we are moving forward, that we are agreeing as much as we can and expressing our differences, but expressing our differences with courtesy and respect when we cannot agree. In this new term, we should be setting out with high ambitions for the next 5 years, and I look forward to working with every member of the Assembly that we will meet those ambitions. So let's work for the days ahead. The next item of business on the order paper is the election of deputy speakers. Standing Order 5.1 requires there to be 3 deputy speakers elected. The procedure for electing deputy speakers will be the same as that of the election of speaker. I will ask for proposals which must be seconded. I will then confirm that the member accepts the nomination and will continue in the way until there are no further proposals. I remind members that a debate may take place after I announce that the time for proposals has passed. Do we have any proposals for the office of Deputy Speaker of the Assembly?
Call Mr. Martin McGuinness.
With your permission, Mr. Speaker, I would like to nominate the member for South Down, Katrina Rian.
Do we have a seconder for Ms. Katrina Rian?
I wish to second that.
Ms. Jennifer McCann. Is the member prepared to accept the nomination?
I agree. I accept the nomination. Thank you.
Is there a further proposal? I call Mr. Colm Eastwood.
Mr. Speaker, can I nominate Mr. Patsy McGlone?
Is there a seconder for Mr. Patsy McGlone?
Mr. Speaker, I second that nomination.
Seconded by Mr. Alex Atwood. Does Mr. McGlone accept the nomination?
Thanks very much. I accept.
Are there any further nominations? Call Mr. Mike Nesbitt.
Mr. Speaker, I nominate Mr. Danny Kennedy.
Is there a seconder for Mr. Danny Kennedy?
Yes, could I second that proposal?
Seconded. Does Mr. Kennedy accept the proposal?
I accept, Mr. Speaker.
I ask, are there any further proposals? The time for proposals has now expired. As a number of members have indicated that they wish to speak, I would remind members that they may speak only once in the course of the debate. Members will have up to 3 minutes in which to speak. I call Mr. Martin McGuinness.
Thank you, Gurma Ugat, Mr. Speaker. I have no hesitation whatsoever in nominating my friend and colleague, Katrina Rian, the member for South Down. She is one of our most experienced MLAs, a former minister, a chief whip in our party, who clearly demonstrated the ability to work with members from other parties in a very positive and a very constructive way. And it was very heartwarming to see, during the course of her stewardship of that position, the way in which she and others interacted, and genuine friendships, I think, were forged. Gender is a very important issue for my party, for Sinn Féin, And I think it is also a very important issue for all of the parties in this Assembly, given the fact that we have seen increased numbers come into the Assembly as a result of the election. So I want to pay tribute to the work that Katrina has done, and also to the women from other parties who have worked with her, to ensure that we continue to forge positive working relationships and indeed friendships, which I believe are very, very important. So I have no hesitation whatsoever in nominating Katrina for this important post.
Call Mr. Mike Nesbitt.
Mr. Speaker, thank you very much. Can I begin by congratulating you on your elevation and wishing you well during the course of the mandate? I am delighted to nominate the MLA from Uri Armagh, Mr. Danny Kennedy. Before I do so, can I pay tribute to Roy Beggs, who performed this role in the previous mandate. Roy brought a professionalism and an attention to detail to the role, for which I think we all benefited. He was quite fearless in the face of some heated debates. He demonstrated that fearlessness in a quite impartial manner. Indeed, I myself, I think, was on the losing side of some of his rulings during the course of the mandate. Those returning from that last mandate will recall that Mr. Kennedy, I think, shouted order from a sedentary position more often than the Speaker from the Speaker's chair. So it is perhaps a relief if we can move him up to the far end of the chamber and make him legal. As we're talking veterans, Danny is a veteran of the Northern Ireland Assembly, a very popular man, a committed politician, and I do believe, Mr. Speaker, he will bring a rather unique and refreshing style to the role. Order.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and can I begin by congratulating you on your elevation. I know that you'll carry out your role with fairness and impartiality as you've done in your previous roles, and can I also thank and congratulate Mr. Mitchell McLaughlin for all the effort that he put in. He was a fair, impartial and at times tough when needed Speaker, and I think he deserves our thanks for that. And also can I give praise to all the other previous Deputy Speakers, and in particular Mr. John Dallet, who isn't in the Assembly anymore. He's somebody that we as a party will miss very much, and I think the people of East Derry will miss him as a public representative. I'm very happy today to propose somebody who was elected to this House first in 2003, somebody who's a previous General Secretary of the SDLP, a Gaelgore, a champion of rural issues, and somebody who in his position as Chair of the Derry Committee showed a great wisdom and fairness and ability to get to the point. We're very glad to propose Mr. Patsy McGlone for the position of Deputy Chair.
Deputy Speaker, sorry. The question is that Katrina Rehan be Deputy Speaker of this Assembly. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no.
No.
The ayes have it. The ayes have it. The question is that Katrina Rehan be Deputy Speaker of this Assembly. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no.
No.
Clear the lobbies. The question will be put in 3 minutes. Thank you. Members will resume their seats. The question is that Katrina Rouillan be Deputy Speaker of this Assembly. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no.
No.
Do we have tellers? As only one teller has been nominated for the noes, the ayes have it. The ayes have it. The question is that Patsy McGlone be Deputy Speaker of this Assembly. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. As there are ayes from all sides of the House and there are no dissenting voices, I am satisfied that cross-community support has been demonstrated. I formally declare that Patsy McGlone has been elected as Deputy Speaker. The question is that Danny Kennedy be Deputy Speaker of this Assembly. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. As there are ayes from all sides of the House and there are no dissenting voices, I am satisfied that cross-community support has been demonstrated. I formally declare that Danny Kennedy has been elected as Deputy Speaker. Yeah. As three Deputy Speakers have been elected, that concludes the item of business. I offer my congratulations to the successful candidates, and I look forward to working with all the Deputy Speakers. As the requirements under Standing Order 5.1 have been fulfilled, it is now appropriate to move on to the election of Principal Deputy Speaker. The next item of business is the nomination of a Deputy Speaker to act as Principal Deputy Speaker. The process will be conducted in accordance with Standing Order 5A. I will begin by asking for a nomination. Any member may rise to nominate one of the Deputy Speakers to act as Principal Deputy Speaker. I will then confirm that the person nominated is willing to act as Principal Deputy Speaker, and then a debate relevant to that nomination will take place. The Business Committee has agreed that only one member should speak on behalf of each party in the debate. At the end of the debate, I will put the question on the nomination. The vote will be on a cross-community basis. If the proposal is not carried, I shall ask for a further nomination and the process will be repeated. Do I have a proposal for Deputy Speaker to be nominated to act as Principal Deputy Speaker? Members should rise to make the proposal. Mr. Martin McGuinness.
With your permission, Mr. Speaker, I wish to nominate the Deputy Speaker, Katrina Rouillan, Member for South Down, as Principal Deputy Speaker.
Do we have a seconder?
Mr. Speaker, I second that nomination.
Deputy Speaker Rouillan, do you agree to act as Principal Deputy Speaker?
Clockham Lesh, I do accept.
Members may only speak once. The Standing Order 5.7 requires the debate to be relevant to the nomination. I will not allow members to stray into any other area. Members will have up to 3 minutes in which to speak. I call Mr. Martin McGuinness.
Mr. Speaker. No hesitation whatsoever. Absolutely delighted to propose Katrina Rouillan, my friend, member for South Down, as the new principal deputy speaker. Further to my comments earlier in regard to her vast experience in this House, her experience as a minister, her work as a chief whip, and her work with colleagues in the Assembly right across the board, she is eminently suited for this position. And as someone who is a very strong advocate for women, I think that we all look forward to you having a great term as Speaker of this House. We wish you every success in the future. But we do look forward in the next term of the Assembly, for the first time in this House since Eileen Bell, a woman Speaker going through the next term of the Assembly. Thank you.
Call Mr. Mike Nesbitt.
Mr. Speaker, thank you very much. Just to make clear, we will not be supporting this nomination, as the Ulster Unionist Party intend to propose Mr. Danny Kennedy as principal deputy speaker.
Do you have a seconder?
Yes, I'm happy.
Proposal.
Okay.
Ms. Rhiann's nomination for Deputy Speaker. Unfortunately, though, we cannot support her nomination for Principal Deputy Speaker, nor can we propose anyone for that position. We don't believe the position has any point. It is a pointless position. It's more about carving out positions than actually making this place work more efficiently and effectively. Therefore, we cannot support this proposal. Thank you.
We want to put on record our compliments to the outgoing Speaker, Mitchell McLaughlin, to wish you well in taking over in the role which you have taken on this afternoon. And I must say, I certainly agree with Colm Eastwood. There has been proven to be little value in having formally a principal deputy speaker. And I do think it would be a sign of maturity in this Assembly if we were to move away from the presumption that the two largest parties occupy Speaker and Principal Deputy Speaker all the time. That said, I welcome you to your role. I recall the fact that while he is established, we no longer have to have a Speaker from Foyle. We have at least returned to a Speaker from East Belfast, who set us off in good terms in 1998.
Call Mr. Jim Allister.
Speaker, first of all, could I congratulate you on your election? I trust it does mean that the National Anthem will be restored to its proper place within the Remembrance event, and that my staff member can cancel his singing lessons. In relation to the position of Principal Deputy Speaker, this is a fictional post. It has no powers above that of Deputy Speaker. It was created, of course, in 2011 as a sop to those with a penchant for titles. Those who in previous life enjoyed various commanding titles felt the need to be appointed as Principal Deputy Speaker, even though it is a post without substance. And, of course, we had the Deputy First Minister once rejoicing in the title of the Steward and Bailiff of the Manor of Northstead. And more infamous and commanding titles besides. But this is an office created as part of the demonstration of the trappings of office of Sinn Féin and the DUP as part of the control freakery. And the person proposed for this has to be the most unsuitable person, a totally divisive figure in this House, a disaster when she was Education Minister, someone who continues to bring division to everyone, everything she touches, and someone whose own claim to fame is probably most infamously that of matron of the Columbia Three. To suggest that such a person should be elevated to the post of Principal Deputy Speaker is an insult to the many victims of the IRA, which she, an organisation whose volunteers she still defends to this day. And it will be interesting to see in this House whether those who spent the last 6 weeks telling us they were in the business of stopping Sinn Féin will in fact today be the facilitators of Sinn Féin to this high office of principal deputy speaker.
I remind the House that cross-community support is required. The question is that the nomination of Deputy Speaker Katrina Ruan to act as Principal Deputy Speaker be approved. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no.
No.
Aye.
Clear the lobbies.
Clear the lobbies. The question will be put in 3 minutes. Order. Tellers have been appointed as follows. Tellers for the ayes are Cathal Boylan and Gerry Kelly. Tellers for the noes are Ross Hussey and Joanne Dobson. Clear the lobbies. The Assembly will divide. Ayes to my right, noes to my left. Thank you.
the doors. Order. Members resume their seats. Members resume their seats. Clerk, read the result.
93 members voted, of which 66 voted aye, 71%. 28 nationalists voted, of which 28 voted aye, 100%. 55 unionists voted, of which 37 voted aye, 67.3%. 10 others voted, of which 1 voted aye, 10%. The motion is carried by cross-community consent.
Motion is carried by cross-community consent. I offer my congratulations to the Principal Deputy Speaker, Katrina Ryan. That concludes this item of business. Next item of business is the appointment of the First Minister and Deputy First Minister. I will conduct the process of filling the offices in accordance with the procedures set out in Section 16A of the Northern Ireland Act 1998 and Standing Order 44.1. I will begin by asking the nominating officer of the largest political party of the largest political designation to nominate a member of the Assembly to be First Minister. I will then ask the nominating officer of the largest political party of the second largest political designation to nominate a member of the Assembly to be the Deputy First Minister. As the persons nominated to fill the vacancies shall not take up office until each of them has affirmed the terms of pledge of office contained in Schedule 4 to the Northern Ireland Act 1998. When I have received both nominations, I will ask each of the persons nominated to accept the nomination and affirm the terms of the pledge of office. Before we proceed, members may find it helpful if the pledge of office is read into the record. Clerk, please read the Pledge of Office.
The Pledge of Office is as follows. To pledge to discharge in good faith all the duties of office. Commitment to non-violence and exclusively peaceful and democratic means. To serve all the people of Northern Ireland equally and to act in accordance with the general obligations on government to promote equality and prevent discrimination. To promote the interests of the whole community represented in the Northern Ireland Assembly towards the goal of a shared future. To participate fully in the Executive Committee the North-South Ministerial Council and the British-Irish Council, to observe the joint nature of the offices of First Minister and Deputy First Minister, to uphold the rule of law, based as it is on the fundamental principles of fairness, impartiality and democratic accountability, including support for policing and the courts as set out in paragraph 6 of the St Andrews Agreement, to support the rule of law unequivocally in word and deed, and to support all efforts to uphold it, to work collectively with other members of the Executive Committee to achieve a society free of paramilitarism, to challenge all paramilitary activity and associated criminality, to call for and to work together with the other members of the Executive Committee to achieve the disbandment of all paramilitary organisations and their structures, to challenge paramilitary attempts to control communities, to support those who are determined to make the transition away from paramilitarism, to accept no authority, direction or control on my political activities other than my democratic mandate alongside my own personal and party judgment. Paragraph 6 of the St Andrews Agreement says, "We believe that the essential elements of support for law and order include endorsing fully the Police Service of Northern Ireland and the criminal justice system, actively encouraging everyone in the community to cooperate fully with the PSNI in tackling crime in all areas, and actively supporting all the policing and criminal justice institutions, including the Policing Board."
Members, the pledge of office has now been read into the record of proceedings, and I will proceed with the nomination process. I have received notification from the nominating officer of the Democratic Unionist Party advising me that Lord Morrow will be served as nominating officer for the party today. I call Lord Morrow to nominate a member of the Assembly to be the First Minister.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. It is with profound pleasure that I nominate my party leader and constituency colleague, Arlene Foster, to this position.
Mrs. Foster, are you willing to take up the office of First Minister and affirm the terms in the pledge of office?
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I confirm that I am willing to take up the office of First Minister, and I affirm the terms of the pledge of office as set out in Schedule 4 of the Northern Ireland Act 1998.
I have received a letter from the nominating officer of Sinn Féin advising me that Jennifer McCann will serve as nominating officer for the party for this item of business. I call Mrs. McCann to nominate a member of the Assembly to be the Deputy First Minister.
Mr. Speaker, it's also a great honour and privilege for me to be asked to make our party's nomination, and I want to make I'm very honoured to make to nominate my long-time friend and colleague, Mr. Martin McGuinness, for Deputy First Minister.
Mr. McGuinness, are you willing to take up the office of Deputy First Minister and affirm the terms of the pledge of office?
Mr. Speaker, I confirm that I am willing to take up the office of Deputy First Minister, and I affirm the terms of the pledge of office as set out in Schedule 4 of the Northern Ireland Act 1998.
There will be an opportunity for speeches. I will begin by calling the First Minister and then the Deputy First Minister to address the House. I call the First Minister, Mrs. Arlene Foster.
Yeah. Mr. Speaker, I'm deeply humbled to have affirmed the pledge of office and to return to Stormont as Northern Ireland's First Minister. When I became First Minister back in January, I said I could think of no greater honour than to serve my country and the people of Northern Ireland. And today, that sense of honour is magnified as I look back at the huge vote of confidence placed in me and my party by the electorate. And the media made much of the election campaign being a personal campaign, and I don't often say it, but in some respects they were right. It was personal. I take the role of First Minister extremely personally. I feel an enormous sense of responsibility, not just to the people who voted for me and my party colleagues, but to everyone who lives here. I'm determined to keep Northern Ireland moving forward and to make it a safer, peaceful and more prosperous place. I want everyone who lives here to be proud of this vibrant, beautiful part of the world. That positive ethos will be at the cornerstone of everything I do over the next 5 years. Now, the election was fought and won on the basis of my five-point plan, and I believe it forms the foundation for a Northern Ireland that can continue to take centre stage for all the right reasons. We have come so far, but with determination and a can-do approach, we have the potential to achieve so much more. When I sat down with my 37 new elected party colleagues on Monday, I told them that I wanted this to be a mandate of delivery. I want to get things done for the people of Northern Ireland. We all have a job of work to do, and the voters have entrusted us to build on our vision for the future. I will work with other parties to get the best results for Northern Ireland, and I believe that over the coming days we can agree a programme for government that will keep us on a winning footing. Mr. Speaker, the past 5 months have been the most demanding and the most rewarding of my life. When I was asked by the media if I was relieved that the electorate had once again voted to make the DUP Northern Ireland's largest party, I said I was elated. I was elated, and I still am. I feel incredibly proud to be Northern Ireland's First Minister. And I've said it many times since January, but it's worth repeating. Growing up as a young girl in rural Fermanagh who wanted to make a difference, who wanted to make Northern Ireland a better place, I could never have dared imagine that one day I would be chosen by the people of Northern Ireland to be their First Minister. So I want to thank everyone who has helped me on this wonderful journey, personally, professionally and politically. I'm immensely grateful to each and every one of you. Public duty isn't always easy, but the worthwhile things in life never are. There may be hurdles and difficulties along the way, but we stand, I believe, on a cusp of a new and exciting era for Northern Ireland. We have a fresh start, we have a new mandate, and we must, and I am determined that we will, capitalise on every opportunity to build on the strong economic foundations to underpin the future stability of Northern Ireland. Thank you.
Yeah. I call the Deputy First Minister, Mr. Martin McGuinness.
Mr. Speaker. Can I say, first of all, heartiest congratulations to every one of the members of this House who have been returned as a result of the recent election. I want to congratulate you on your appointment as the new Speaker and the widespread support that there is in the Assembly for your appointment is, I think, testimony to the belief in this House that you will follow in the footsteps of William Hay and Mitch McLaughlin and be a Speaker that we can be proud of. I want to thank Jennifer, my friend and colleague, for the nomination. I want to thank my party. I want to pay tribute to the 27 other members of my party who were elected in the course of this election, and to thank very wholeheartedly every one of those people in the constituencies who voted for Sinn Féin. I want to congratulate Arlene on her appointment as First Minister. She and I and our ministerial colleagues, when they are appointed, will have a huge responsibility to move forward, to continue to deliver on the Fresh Start Agreement, which is now over 6 months old. And it has been a good start, but there is more work to be done, not least putting in place the final piece of the jigsaw in relation to victims and how we deal with the past. And I earnestly hope, in the aftermath of the putting together of the programme for government and the appointment of ministers, that in our discussions with the Secretary of State, that a way forward to meet the needs of victims, all victims, can be found. There was a lot of talk during the course of the election of colours and who was what colour and who wasn't, orange and green and red, white and blue. I am a very proud, unapologetic Irish Republican, and my politics are green, white and orange, because I do believe in bringing the green and the orange together and the white of peace in the middle. And I do think that at some stage in the future, that is absolutely achievable. I absolutely respect those people on the other side of this House who are red, white and blue. The challenge for us and the challenge for Arlene and myself and for other ministers is for us to continue with the good start, to recognise the importance of working together, building new relationships, putting the past 3 years to the dustbin of history, and moving on to deliver for the people that we represent. Because I want to live in a society which is diverse, and our society is diverse, but I want that to be an inclusive society. I want us to stand up for those who are discriminated against. I want us to stand up for the marginalised, for the poor, for those who feel that they are not being treated fairly. And I want to stand up alongside ministerial colleagues to deliver on tackling social deprivation and providing much needed employment for the people that we represent. All of that represents a huge challenge to us, because one of the great difficulties that we faced during the course of the last, particularly the last term of the Assembly, was the austerity agenda being imposed on us by a Conservative government in London, a government that cut billions out of our block grant. And of course, during the last term of the Assembly, opportunities were taken by opportunistic politicians to blame the executive and blame this Assembly for that. It was a very dishonest approach, in my opinion, because nowhere did I hear in the criticisms of the executive any criticism of the economic policies being pursued by a Conservative administration in London, which were detrimentally affecting our ability as elected politicians here to deliver for all of our people, whether they live in East Belfast, West Belfast, the Bogside, or Portadown. So this is an opportunity for all of us to move forward. Ideologically, we are different from the unionists. Nothing wrong with that. Everybody's entitled to their position. Allegiance-wise, we are completely different. But I come from that school of thought that fervently believes that we have the ability to work together, that not alone can we build positive working relationships, we can build friendships which will last until the day we die. I've done it with Ian Paisley. Ian Paisley done it with me. Queen Elizabeth and myself had all sorts of reasons not to meet with each other, but we rose above it in the interest of trying to show people that reconciliation was achievable. So we need reconciliation within our society. So let's all go forward together. We're all human beings. We all represent people. People out there depend on us, and we have a duty and a responsibility to live up to their expectations. And I pledge today, as my final comment in the course of what I have to say, to work with our unionist colleagues in a positive, responsible, constructive spirit to build a better future for everyone. Gurumila Mayogov.
There will now be an opportunity for others to speak. Members should limit their remarks to not more than 3 minutes. I have the names of some members who have already indicated that they wish to speak, but could I ask all members who would like to speak to contribute to the debate to rise in their places, and I will endeavour to accommodate as many as possible. The briefer you are, the more opportunity there will be for others. I call Mr. Mike Nesbitt.
Mr. Speaker, thank you very much. Can I begin by congratulating the other 107 successful candidates who are gathered here today as members of this Legislative Assembly? And also to commiserate with the unsuccessful candidates. I know the feeling of not finding favour with the electorate, and it is not a feeling or an experience I would choose to repeat. My congratulations to Mrs. Foster and to Mr. McGuinness. On behalf of the Ulster Unionist Party, I wish them well in their onerous leadership positions for these devolved institutions. I think it's noteworthy that, if not a cause for concern, that none of the five big parties grew in numbers in this election. Two shared a couple of seats each. The other three of us just managed to maintain the status quo. But this is not the time to rerun the election and its themes. I will settle instead to repeat my good wishes to Mrs. Foster and to Mr. McGuinness. Like any executive minister or any other member of this Legislative Assembly, they will have my support and the support of the Ulster Unionist Party when the time is right. Where they will not have our support is at the executive table, because the Ulster Unionist MLA group have decided unanimously to form the first official opposition of this Northern Ireland Assembly. This is a big and bold move to bring a better and a more normal democracy to the people of Northern Ireland. Let battle commence.
Call Mr. Colm Eastwood.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. No announcements coming, just to you. Can I first of all offer my sincere congratulations to the First and Deputy First Minister. The people have spoken, and we're very glad to support your nominations. It is a very difficult job, you both know that, and you will have our support when you deserve it. We have, I think, some work to do before any of us should be making any announcements about whether or not we're going into government. I fought, and we fought this election on the basis that we would negotiate hard, work hard, put forward proposals for the programme for government. We continue to do that, and we'll see where that goes. We want to see a programme for government that we can sign up to. If we can't, we'll be in opposition, but if we can, we'll be in government. We want that programme for government to look after the people who've been left behind, to look after the areas that have been left behind, and begin to make this place about delivery. It was Peter Robinson, this time 5 years ago, who said, 5 years from now, we'll not be judged on the size of our first preference votes, but on what we have done to make life better for the people whom we represent. We will be judged on delivery. I don't often quote Peter Robinson, Mr. Speaker, but I think on that particular occasion he was speaking sense. I don't think anybody, though, out there will say that we have delivered what we could deliver. For me, this next mandate, whether we're in government or opposition, we'll work constructively to ensure that we can deliver as much as we possibly can for all of those people who so dearly need our help. Thank you.
Mr. David Ford.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Can I add my congratulations to Arlene Foster and to Martin McGuinness? It is clear their parties have been given a mandate to lead the government. The challenge now is to turn it into delivery and not just some of the promises which we saw. Can I congratulate Mike Nesbitt on the soundbite of the day? But some of us believe that government is a bit more substantial than the soundbite of the day. And can I congratulate Colm Eastwood on the quote of the day? Because the sad reality is that the Executive and the Assembly over the last 5 years did not deliver all that was promised when we stood here 5 years ago. And there is much that still remains to be done. And that is a challenge for those who have been given office today, and it's a challenge for others who will join them, and it's a challenge for the Assembly to hold the Executive to account. There is absolutely no doubt that despite the votes that were given, they were given by only 55% of our people. And there's a very substantial body that does not believe that this Assembly has delivered in the 18 years we've had. But I will say to the First Minister and the Deputy First Minister that if they're going to take action on those key issues, then they will get the support of the Alliance Party and the work that they are doing in the right direction. And if they do not, then they will be getting challenged by us, because there is a need to ensure that delivery is achieved in key issues, in particular to deal with the threat which still exists of violence, which we've been so sadly reminded of in recent days on our streets, of the need to move to a united community so those divisions will be overcome and that violence will be ended. That is what we have unfortunately failed so far to do in 18 years. That is the challenge which needs to be addressed, and it is up to those who have just assumed office to lead that challenge, and it's up to the rest of us to ensure that that carries through.
Lord Moran.
Mr. Speaker, and just before I say anything more, could I congratulate you on your being elevated to the position of Speaker? I think I have certainly confidence in you that you'll do an excellent job, as you did do when you were Principal Deputy Speaker, and I wish you well. And I hope that I and everyone around this chamber today will give you the support that I think you deserve. Let me congratulate my party colleague, Arlene Foster, on her position here as First Minister. This is, I think, an historic day in relation to Northern Ireland. I am sure it has not gone unnoticed that during the election campaign and when the results were announced, that Arlene Foster secured the largest personal vote of any MLA in the chamber today. And I don't think anybody has missed that point. And I certainly didn't anyway, as a constituency colleague of hers and one who fought the election along with her. I know the energy that this woman brings to anything, and you can take my word for it. She is full of energy, and I want to wish her well in the weeks, the months, the years that lie ahead. I have no doubt that Arlene Foster will bring much good to Northern Ireland, whether it's in Northern Ireland or outside of Northern Ireland. She will be a great ambassador for this part of the United Kingdom, and I want to wish her every success. In relation to Mr. Nesbitt's announcement, it's obvious he has lost the battle within his own party, and we have had the outfall of it here today, because during the election campaign there was no strategy from him at all. He was neither in nor out, and now, because he has now tested his own party and they have said, Mike, it's time to get out, I suspect the next call will be, time, Mike, for you to go. Thank you very much.
Call Mrs. Jennifer McCann.
Mr. Speaker, can I just first of all start off by congratulating Arlene on her reappointment as First Minister, both from myself and from on behalf of our party here. And I just want to say again, it was a great honour and privilege to ask to nominate Martin for Deputy First Minister. I think that everyone knows the committed and tireless worker that he is, but everyone has seen the great leadership that he has shown, not just within these institutions, but also to people outside these institutions, and that's right around the world. He's his style of leadership is highly respected. He doesn't ask anyone to do anything that he wouldn't do himself. And he's never been afraid to challenge those who have tried to, you know, disrupt or destroy the peace process, or disrupt the political institutions and the political process that we have made such progress on. And, you know, I think that he puts the hand of friendship out to anyone, and I think that that's really the sort of sense of the person that you have. I know that as working with him in the Office of First and Deputy First Ministers, Junior Minister, and indeed with my other ministerial colleagues, you know, we have all seen the great personal sacrifice that he has given to that role, and the tireless energy that he has all the time. You know, he's always there. He's the one that's always out front. He's the one always doing, you know, most of the difficult, if you like, the difficult lifting for the rest of us. But I think that it's really, he's earned the respect of people right across the political divide, and he has set a really high bar for leadership. And I know that we can go into this new mandate with, you know, a true leader at our side, that we can go into this mandate that with someone who will work with anyone, who is genuine about partnership working, who is genuine about power sharing, and, you know, his style of leadership, as I said, you know, gives us a lot of sort of determination and commitment ourselves to take the progress that we've made and make further progress in that. So, thank you.
Mr. Jim Allister.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Anyone looking at the order paper today and seeing the item appointment of First Minister and Deputy First Minister might be forgiven for thinking there would have to be a vote on such a matter, as there was yesterday in the Welsh Assembly on the appointment of First Minister. But any new member of this House who came expecting to be allowed to vote on this issue, well, welcome to Stormont. And of course, the reason there isn't a vote is that the rules were changed to save the blushes of the DUP. The DUP that for the past 6 weeks has spent the time with the deceptive message that they were in the business of stopping Sinn Féin. And then today, when it comes to the appointment of the equal office of First and Deputy First Minister, to save their blushes of walking through the lobbies to put their partner, Martin McGuinness, in as equal into that office, the situation is contrived where there's no vote. But of course, that's to save that embarrassment, although I do have to say, embarrassment comes very difficult now to the DUP benches. Because last September, the First Minister told us that Sinn Féin was inextricably linked to the IRA. This week, the Chief Constable told us nothing had changed. They still existed, still had the structures. And of course, as far as Sinn Féin is concerned, nothing has changed. They still deny the reality of the IRA. But for the DUP, it doesn't matter. Office matters more than any of that. And so the lure of office overcomes any principle, any talk about inextricable linkage. But in the words of the First Minister, she is now partnering a party in government inextricably linked to the IRA, which the Chief Constable says still exists. Says it all for me, Mr. Speaker. Unless there's any doubt, my position will continue to be one of opposition to this dysfunctional government.
I call Mr. Eamon McCann.
Mr. Speaker, I rise only to comment on one of the remarks made by the Deputy First Minister when he referred to opportunist politicians or political parties which concentrate their fire, he said, on the executive in relation to austerity and let the British government off the hook. The British government, which, as he accurately remarked, is the original source of the austerity measures. Let me make it clear that actually the Deputy First Minister didn't make it absolutely clear to whom he was referring. Lest there be any possibility whatever that he included people before profit in the strictures that he was making about people not attacking the British government strongly enough, let me say that we deny and refute that absolutely. We question whether there's any political party represented in this assembly which has more vigorously and more consistently, and in association with our comrades and brothers and sisters across the water, no other party has fought so hard and so directly against the austerity measures emanating from Westminster. Our criticism of the executive was not that to put all the blame on them, but to draw attention to the fact that they weren't fighting hard enough. That against the Tories. That was our criticism. And let me say that we're faced with a situation in which, well, the Tory party across the water, with more austerity in mind, The Tory party is in disarray. The vote, whichever way it goes, on the 23rd, it will be toast. It will be completely dysfunctional. What I'm saying is that this is the time to put on the pressure against the Tories. This is no time to hide behind constitutionality and the position of the executive. If you're against austerity, fight against austerity.
I simply wanted to point out to you, Mr. McCann, that since you had strayed from the microphone, that Hansard was not able to pick up what you were saying.
You want me to say it again? Quite happy.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I'm not even trying to follow that, thank you. Mr. Speaker, it's my first opportunity. I would like to welcome you to your new position and congratulate your new deputies also. I congratulate the incoming First and Deputy First Minister. But I think it is clear, and we've seen it already today, we do have an emboldened opposition corner. We will provide an effective challenge to those who choose to take up seats in the executive. I've said all throughout the election campaign that the Green Party wants to see delivery for the people of Northern Ireland. If that comes from the executive, we will welcome it. But if it doesn't come, we will lead the way in bringing forward the change that Northern Ireland needs. Just today, there was a queue outside the Bill's office door to see who could be the first to bring forward legislation for marriage equality. I brought forward that first motion in the last Assembly, a time when other parties didn't want to speak about it. Now, parties are literally crawling over each other, trying to be first to get to the door to bring forward that legislation. That's the effect an opposition can have, and regardless of whether it's a formal opposition or an informal opposition, as we've had here in this corner, that's the role that my party plans to operate. It's a constructive opposition. It's an opposition seeking change, but it's about delivery for the people of Northern Ireland, not for opposition's sake. No opposition without positive proposals for change. That's what we have seen from the Green Party, and now with my colleague Claire Bailey, that's what we can expect even more of.
I call Ms. Sugden.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. It's my pleasure to stand here as the only independent MLA in Northern Ireland. I think what my success demonstrates, Mr. Speaker, is the fact that people are getting sick of the old party system. And I think what today might demonstrate, actually, is a scene change in politics in Northern Ireland. We have our first principal deputy speaker, and whilst I voted against it on the principle of the institutions and carving it up between the two main parties, I think that's a good thing for women in politics. We move forward into these next 5 years where we have a female first minister, and I am pleased to say that. I just want to add my comments about the opposition, and I want to say fair play to the Ulster Unionist Party. Things are changing, Mr. Speaker. And I think Northern Ireland is about to move forward. This election for me marks Northern Ireland really moving on to the issues that matter to people on the ground, and I look forward to the next 5 years. Congratulations to all those MLAs who were elected to the Assembly, and I look forward to working with every single one of you. Thank you.
Members, that concludes that item. We will now move to the next item of business appearing on the order paper. The next item on the order paper is a motion to appoint the Business Committee. This will be treated as a business motion, so there will be no debate. Clerk, please read the motion.
That the following shall be appointed to be members of the Business Committee: the Speaker, ex officio, Mr. Alex Atwood, Mr. Trevor Clark, Mr. Stuart Dixon, Mr. Gerry Kelly, Mr. Colin McGrath, Mrs. Sandra Overend, Ms. Katrina Ruan, Mr. Robin Swan, and Mr. Peter Weir.
I beg to move the motion. The question is that the motion standing on the order paper be agreed. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Before we move to the adjournment, I wish to advise the House that the Northern Ireland Act 1998, recently amended to the Stormont Agreement and Implementation Plan Act 2016, requires the offices of the ministers to be appointed within 14 days from today. When the parties have indicated that they are ready for this to take place, the Business Committee will meet to consider an order paper for the next meeting. Item 8 on the order paper, the adjournment. The question is that the Assembly do now adjourn. The Assembly is now adjourned.